Ladies and gentlemen, nerds and neckbeards, welcome to another edition of Westeros Whenever-ly. This is episode number 22.
Dose.
Never fold the pocket ducks.
Never what?
Never fold the pocket ducks.
I don't even know what it's a poker term. That means.
It's a two when you have two twos in your hand.
Yeah.
Never fold them
because never fold.
You never know. Ducks stick together. That's all I'm saying. Anyway.
Hey. All right. Well. On that note.
All men
must drink.
Must drink. Tana, why don't you tell our listeners the beautiful drink that I created
that
tonight?
That you created.
Well,
I'm so impressed.
It was help. We did it together.
It was. You know what?
It was teamwork.
Makes the dream work.
That. Ooh.
Yeah,
we are
drinking Shade of the Evening tonight, which is known as the Wine of Warlocks. And so thinking about that and the fact that we have a gallon of Blue Curacao, obviously it's got Blue Curacao. And then
we're drinking pure Blue
ounces.
Curacao. Yeah. That's all we're drinking tonight. It's
and then
delicious.
They died of like sugar or whatever. They could go into comas or something.
Oh, God.
So it's Blue Curacao and then a little bit of red wine. I'm not using a good red wine. Use a regular table red, something that isn't excellent. My favorite is the Bota Box of wine. I always have it at my house.
Oh, yeah. Box wine.
It's like $17 and it's equivalent to 4 bottles of perfectly decent red wine. So if you don't want to open a bottle, you just like, it has a little spigot. It's wine in a box.
Yeah, it's good.
It's perfect. So we have Bota Box red wine. I think it's their Cab Sav. So let's say 3 ounces of that, 2 ounces of Blue Curacao. And then brilliantly, we went into your fridge to see, like, what the hell does Dave have that we can round out this drink with?
It's not much.
It's not.
But.
I brought over tonic water because I was like, it's not going to taste like anything, but it'll give us some bubbles. I hadn't completed the idea for the drink.
You hadn't completed the circuit.
Yeah, and so I came to Dave, and what did you have, lo and behold?
So, lo and behold, I had some homemade by a good coworker and friend of mine. Shout out to Scott.
Hey, Scott.
He's a brewer and makes his own wine, or in this case, it was a cider. And we had some homemade cider.
Yeah.
Brewed by my friend Scott, and we added that to this drink, and it took it from to hot damn, this
hot
is a
damn.
Good drink.
Hot damn.
This is a Shade of the Evening.
It's Shade of the Evening. I'm looking for the actual thing, and what was our shot tonight?
Our shot, which was a little follow-up from last week, because last week we mentioned that we had these hollowed-out strawberries, and you had mentioned that you should dip them in chocolate.
Yeah.
And
that
so
was like the end of our last podcast. We were talking about this. You came up with the idea, I think. And you asked if you could have it. You were like, white chocolate, because I love white chocolate.
Yeah.
And it works out great.
And it tastes
so good.
Because I was
like, oh, we have to do it on an episode about Bloodraven, which this isn't an episode about Bloodraven, but he is going to make an appearance.
Yeah.
So it all comes full circle. So we're doing Albino Bloodraven shots, which are
a nice strawberry hollowed out, dipped in white chocolate. And frozen, of course.
Yep.
Well, not frozen, but refrigerated.
Yeah, refrigerated. I cut the little... So I hollowed out all these fresh strawberries and cut off just... I dipped them... No, what did I do? I hollowed them out first, and then I cut off the very tip of the strawberry so that it would stand up.
Mm.
And if you cut off the tip and then hollow it out, you're going to pop a hole in the bottom of the strawberry.
Whatever you do, don't cut the tip off.
Yeah, don't cut the tip. Don't dip the tip.
Yeah, don't put the teeth away, please.
What about if you're Jewish?
Well,
that's
I am Jewish, and my tip is nipped.
Maybe you just have a little sensitivity to the nip tip.
I do, just a little bit, just a little.
Snipping the tip of the nip. Jesus.
Okay.
Anyway, so you take your strawberry, you melt your Godiva white chocolate in the microwave.
It has to be Godiva.
Yep. My microwave has a melt setting that I found very quickly. Like,
well,
you never
aren't
use
you
anything.
Fancy?
I know,
yeah.
Right?
You never use any buttons like the popcorn button.
Yeah.
No one ever uses the popcorn button.
No one ever does. And this one, I was like, oh, there's a melt button. I wonder. So I press it, and it was like, press 1 for this, 2 for chocolate. And I was like, oh, 2. And then it's like, press 1 for 1 pound of, you know, semi-whatever chocolate. And I was like, oh, I'll do that. So it was just a couple of button presses, and the whole stuff melts down. And then you dip your strawberries and stand them up on some parchment paper. And then they solidified, and they're like these little shot cups.
Yeah, they're perfect.
Yeah.
And so we poured some delicious...
Do you want to do it right now?
Yeah, let's do them. We poured what? Some Disaronno in it?
It's Disaronno.
Disaronno. Which we thought was just almond liqueur, but it turns out it's not.
So it's just straight up.
Don't give me the one with the hole in it.
I have the one with the hole in it. I'm going to plug the hole with my little finger here.
That's what she
said. You think I should do it? Well, just do it.
Okay. And then just do it right now.
You're going
to
get...
I'll do it.
Okay, well, do I'm going to do it without you.
Just do it without me. Go, put it in your mouth. Jesus Christ. Just put it in your mouth already. Oh, she did. It's gone.
Okay.
Oh, now it's my turn.
So I made these for our...
Oh, God, mine's leaking too.
Yeah, plug the hole, plug the hole.
I plugged it.
You got to get in there, dude. You got to get in there. And the chocolate is, like, nice and chunky. Not chunky, but, like, kind of crunches. Like... Mm. It's just delicious. So, I made these. I made these so that for the season 6 episode, the
premiere.
The premiere. I made them and brought them over for the premiere, which we watched together.
So, for those of you who know, Dan is an utmost hater of the show.
Mm-hmm. The books are so much better.
There you go. I was waiting for that.
Yeah.
However, I did make her watch the season 6 premiere, and she enjoyed it.
I really enjoyed it. There were some really fun moments. And, you know, it's very exciting. I know that there are a lot of people out there, like me, who are show haters, and I'm hoping maybe we can bring some of them along for our ride today, just to talk about maybe some of the highs and lows of it, and the
big... Yeah.
Because there are going to be some things that are revealed, you know. I have said, it's no secret that I think the show does a terrible job of presenting a lot of the material of the books.
Yeah.
But now
we're kind of on our own, so they may do a really good job of presenting their own material.
Yep.
And I think they did a good job with certain things. Anyway, let's get into the discussion of the episode.
Okay.
So we'll start there. It was a season 6 premiere.
Yep.
So everyone kind of knew that it wasn't going to be very detailed, not a lot super was going to happen.
Yep.
It wasn't going to be this huge reveal.
Right. However, nobody expected Jon Snow to be resurrected in this first episode. At least I don't think any single person thought that.
Any smart, reasonable person. I'm sure there's a lot of people out there who are like, they didn't do it. What the fuck?
There's a difference between expecting it and being disappointed, or like wanting it to happen and not having it happen and then like expecting
it. Yeah. I mean, if they did it in the first episode, who would watch the second? But I mean, everyone would watch the second, but anyway.
You want to string it out a little bit.
Yeah. And so they did a great job of touching on a lot of the cliffhangers, at least bringing us into that world again of a lot of the cliffhangers that they left off with. So, you know, one of them being Sansa Stark and Theon. They jumped off the cliff. That's where they leave them.
Yep.
Off the roof of Winterfell. Excuse me, off the wall of Winterfell into the snow pile.
Yep.
And they tag Brienne with that again, which I think is a good move.
I think it's I found it less jarring than I expected, dropping from the book world, which doesn't have Brienne's in the Riverlands. Davos isn't at the wall, like nobody, Stannis is alive and well, like there's no real similarities.
Davos is out hunting for Bran and Rickon, from Sir Too Fat to Sit a Horse.
But
I agree. I think they did a good job. I think Sansa is definitely taking over the Lady Stoneheart role.
Yeah.
She's going to amass an army in the Riverlands, and I think that's where they're going next.
And you think that they're going to rally around Sansa?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah?
Yeah. I think they're going to be like, the daughter of the fallen House Tully.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and she's a Stark.
And, so she becomes a Stark in Winterfell.
Yeah.
She becomes our Lady
For
Stark.
Now. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
After that, they bring us to Dorne a little bit. And we see...
By and large, everyone has panned as the worst of the worst of the worst.
Well, so,
I have a game for us to play.
It's about
the episode. Oh. I think we should do like maybe a little recap, because it's not actually like I came up with this hilarious idea and I want to see how it's going to work. It's not Stump Dave, but it's very similar in that it's a game show within our conversational podcast show.
All right, you want to jump right to that then?
Yeah, maybe so. Okay, let's play the game. And then whatever we don't cover, we can cover conversationally after. How about that?
All right. Are you listeners down for that? I guess they don't have a choice.
Since it's a live show, they don't really have a choice.
I mean, you could call me right now or tweet me right now, but you probably wouldn't know that I'm casting because this goes up afterwards. Oh, you have music? Oh, my God.
All right, Dave, are you ready to play our game?
Let's do it.
Ooh, do you know
Price is Right?
Close.
Oh, it's Family Feud.
Feud of Thrones.
Woo! Feud of Thrones. The survey says,
yes, exactly.
Is it on the board? Wait, we need Steve Harvey, though.
Exactly.
Come on.
I know, so I have to be your stand-in Steve Harvey
okay.
for Feud of Thrones.
Give me Dave and give me Dave. Bring me the buzzer. All right.
Dave and Dave, let's see you down front.
Okay.
So, let's see here. We top five funniest show moments from the season 6 premiere.
Did you? So, wait. First,
yep.
I want to know.
Yep.
Where did you get these polls
I'm
from?
I'm about to tell you.
Oh, okay.
We interviewed 100 fake drunk people to get the top 5 answers to what were the funniest moments of the Game of Thrones season 6 premiere.
100 fake drunk people?
Yeah, fake drunk people.
What? Are they fake people or fake drunk?
It's,
are they people that are faking being drunk? Or
it's stuff what? That Tana came up with because I thought they were funny parts
okay.
of the show. And so I figured that if you guess the top 5, let's see what's on the board. Who's going to buzz in first?
All right. I guess I am.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, buzz in, Dave.
Oh. Ding.
Yes, Dave. What is one of the 5 funniest moments of the season 6
premiere?
Premiere.
When Tristane gets stabbed in the back of the head after he stupidly chooses the other sister.
Show me. Get stabbed in the back of the head.
Yeah. What number was it?
That was number 3.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Here we go. So now the board is yours.
Oh, do I want to play or pass or play?
Pass or play?
I'm gonna pass. No one ever passes on Family Feud. They always play, but I'm gonna pass. I'm doing
it. Okay. Well, I know what all the answers are. So Dave, you're up next.
Oh, okay.
Really, this would be a good game for us to play if we had like a visitor, and then we can go back and forth. But we don't have
should.
Any friends.
We do have friends.
We
they
could
just,
yeah. We could get Pantano.
That's a good idea.
Pantano was over. He could come over.
Yeah.
And play against you.
You could.
Next time with a little bit of planning.
Next time if with the planning. All right, let's go through
four
these.
Four more on the board.
Four
what
more
were
on the board.
Funniest moments in the Game of Thrones premiere? I need a marker so that I can mark off the ones that we got.
Okay, I'm gonna have to go with Mr. Pod feeding Sansa her lines.
That's right.
To say hello, bread and meat and mead. You can have a place by my hearth.
Yes.
Of course,
that's right.
Brienne.
That's correct.
Woo! Man, we even have
four.
Sound effects now?
Yeah.
God, we're getting so
and
professional.
So you've got 3 left.
Oh, man.
Doo-doo-doo.
Don't play the music again.
Well,
I don't want to hear it. Oh, God. All right, let's see.
You got 3, Dave. 3 more.
What's
funniest
another,
moments. Come
another...
on. It's the, like, most obvious one.
Well,
it was
I think,
the best dialogue.
I think,
everyone was talking about it after.
I think it's when... Melisandre takes off her. You see her titties, and then all of a sudden, she takes off her brooch, and it's a pan back, and there it is. It's a.
Nope, that was the most terrifying moment. We're talking about funny moments.
Funny moments.
Yep. I'll give you one of them. Davos's hilarious request for mutton. That would have been one of them.
Oh yes, that was a good. That was a good one.
Yeah. And so, what's the number one? Most hilarious moment of the whole show, a conversation is happening with, let's say, a mother of dragons, and
oh yeah, of course, when they say, what are they talking about, raping
yeah,
or something,
he's
a girl?
Like,
he's
seeing
like,
a girl, a woman naked for the first time is the best thing there is.
And then his blood riders are like, what about raiding a Khalasar?
That's what one of the best things.
What about...
So we have it down as the Dothraki trolls.
Yes,
was
the
our
Dothraki
number one
trolls.
Answer was
oh,
the Dothraki
yeah.
trolls.
That was a good one. That
I
was
have,
such like a Conan O'Brien moment
yeah.
or something like that. It
yeah.
was like,
and it was so
Jimmy
funny.
Fallon.
Like that was actually really amusing, which I thought really offset the absurdity of the fact that that conversation was happening at all.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Because Dany is... a Khaleesi. She knows what the rules are.
Uh-huh.
So there's no way that any of that actually, like, you just, in order to enjoy the show, you have to suspend your disbelief. And that's part of it, right? Because if they find her, the Blood Riders, or any of the Khalasar finds her, and
yeah.
they're circling her at the end of the last episode, then they either enslave her, rape and enslave her, murder her or recognize who she is, and then they don't touch her because they have to take her to Vaes Dothrak. So the fact that she would just be allowed to walk along unmolested by the Dothraki culls who are like, you know, trolling, or not the culls, but the riders who are trolling her and like making all these like sexual references while she's just sort of stoically walking along is absurd. And then for her to talk to the Dothraki guy, the call, and be like, I am Daenerys Stormborn, blah, 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 blah. She knows, she was a Khaleesi. She knows that the guy's got to take her to Vaes Dothrak. Like, that's the only thing that's going to happen. So
I think it was funny. It's another moment where, in fact, this parallels another moment in the book as well, where she's kind of playing dumb at first and like not speaking their language. And then all of a sudden she busts out Dothraki and they're like,
that was
what?
During the, when she got her Unsullied, right?
That's right. Yeah. The whole time she, you know, speaks High Valyrian and they're talking and she's got a translator. And then at the very end, she's
like, tell the whore this, tell the, you know, slut this, tell her this. And then, is it Missandei? Yeah, Missandei. Was like, she realizes at the end that Dany has started to speak their language. And she's like, what? You know, right before Dracarys. That's the episode of Dracarys. All right, Dave, do you want to play another episode?
I guess let's move on to the next category.
Congratulations, Dave. You're still in control of the board.
Woohoo!
On Feud of Thrones. I honestly have way too much time.
Like, I can tell.
Work alone.
I can tell.
Okay. So, we interviewed 100 fake drunk people.
Again?
Yeah, to get the top answers to what are the major differences between the show and the book.
Well, but how do we claim this when the show kind of moves past some things?
Yeah.
But, okay. Anyway.
I thought about doing a Twitter poll, but since my last Twitter poll was so successful.
Yeah, it was super successful.
I decided not to do it.
Okay.
And just, like, make up the answers on my own.
Fair enough.
I think our listeners will understand.
I think they will.
And they're going to be on board with it.
I think they appreciate your sense of righteousness for the books.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, top six differences.
Okay, well,
between the show and the book.
One, I guess in this episode, Sansa and Brienne, right? So Brienne is in the Riverlands.
I have that lumped together with just one word, which is the North.
Okay.
Which I guess is two words.
Yeah, that is two words.
It's all kind of messed up. The North is a mess.
Bit. It's a mess.
Sansa's up there.
Yeah.
Theon is up there. Well, I
Theon
guess.
Theon is kind of up there. Stannis
is
still
dead.
Alive in the books.
Who are these Night's Watchmen? Like, there's no Gren. There's no, I guess,
Grennan,
I guess Dolorous Ed is around, right?
Dolorous Ed is that
but
guy with the long
else.
Hair. Well, Gren and Pip died
they're still alive in the book.
Yeah.
So everybody that's like Jon's buddy you know, Alistair Thorne is not part of any big conspiracy. I mean, he hates Jon, but he's not one of the guys that stabs him at the end. It's Beau and Marsh.
Yeah.
But I guess that the show has conflated Beau and Marsh and Alistair Thorne into the same. But no, he looks at Bowen.
Bowen's there.
There's a character. He's just not empowered.
Yeah, he Alistair says it at the end. He's like, I did it, Bowen Marsh did it, and the rest of the officers.
Who is this snot-nosed kid off to the side grinning like a, like
that's
a maniac?
That's just some kid that they added in.
Because he killed all John's friends.
Well, so he, you know, John saves him. The wildlings raid that kid's town, and John kind of saves him. He's not a wildling. He's a he's a northern kid,
a northern
commoner.
Okay.
And but his family dies and his village dies, so he goes to the Castle Black for safety or whatever. And, and he's actually the one who kills Ygritte.
Yep.
Ygritte.
Oh.
The
well,
kid kills Ygritte. Ygritte
ridiculous.
And, Ygritte and Jon are like in this struggle, right? Right. And they're fighting. They're fighting a little bit, right?
Because she's trying to take over Castle Black. Or
whatever. Exactly. They're fighting, and then all of a sudden, like. You know, John's like, don't kill me. And Ygritte's like about to like drop her sword. And then all of a sudden an arrow comes through her heart.
They love that shot. They love that surprise, dead shot.
Yeah. And it was the kid who did it.
Yep.
You know. And then, you know, the kid's all pissed off at John because John let the wildlings in.
So are the wildlings on the...
They're in the gift.
They're in the gift. Okay, so when Dolorous Ed was like, I'll go get the wildlings.
Yeah, Davos is like, he's not the only, you know, right. We're not the only ones who owe our lives to Jon Snow.
Right, right.
Dollar's head is like, oh, fuck, the wildlings.
That mutton thing was awesome.
Oh, that was pretty good.
Oh, my God, that was just that. So, House of Thorn, nice,
make your demand.
I'm not much of a hunter and in this north, so maybe a little mutton would be great.
A little mutton would be good.
Yep. Oh, Davos. Let's see. So, that's one of the six. Ding.
That's only one of the six. All right.
Yeah, let's pretend that I had that already.
Let's go with Dorne.
Correct! Yeah, Dorne, number yeah, one. Dorne, so number one. Stupid.
So, everyone, I think, is all in agreement yeah. that they completely simplified the Dorne's plot lines.
It seems and like they didn't know what they were doing with it.
I 100% agree, because, I mean, we see in the end of season five,
yeah.
Tristan is on the boat yeah. with
the
daughter. Fuck. Yeah,
fucking Golden Curls.
Yeah,
there.
What's her name? Wow, this is terrible. Yeah. Oh my God.
Wow, the shade of the evening is supposed to bring us wisdom.
Jesus Christ.
Not, it didn't,
Marcella.
Not totally yeah, Marcella. Minds.
It's the silly game show. No.
There is a drink called Mind Eraser. Oh, yeah, it's the pressure of the game show.
So,
you're in the hot seat.
Tristan is on the boat with Marcella and Jaime
yep.
in the show at the end of season five. He's not on the dock.
Yep.
And the two sand snakes are on the dock. And then...
Because apparently teleporting is a thing.
And then in this episode, you see Jaime Lannister and the body
yeah.
on a boat, like, not on the main boat, but on, like, a little boat coming into the port.
Yeah, yeah.
And so then I guess we assume that Tristan is on the main boat.
Yeah.
And two of his sand snake sisters apparently are there.
Right.
And they're just like, oh, crap. That's a funny moment then, because she's like, I pick you, and he pulls a sword out, and then the other
you never turn your back on, if two people are there to kill you, don't turn your back on one of them.
Yeah, that's just stupid.
Like, that's just...
But, okay, so that's a big difference. So, the thing about Dorne, though, is like everyone stated, they completely simplified their plot lines, which is upsetting, because I think the Dornish plot lines are some...
hugely important.
And I think they're some of the more interesting plot lines at this point, because we've heard so much about the North and the Riverlands and the Tullys and the Lannisters. Then all of a sudden you have this sweet, awesome, like, Targaryen stronghold in Dorne, you know?
Yeah.
And it's just like they're waiting for the true kings to come back, or at least to go to war with the Lannisters.
Question. Yeah.
And I do think...
Fake Aegon, is he in the show at all?
He's not in the show.
Okay.
Do
we know if he's gonna be in the show?
Maybe. I don't know. They haven't led up to it at all. But
I guess everyone's being kind of tight-lipped about what is and what isn't gonna be in
the
show.
Yeah, and I think that makes sense. I think both the show and the books are gonna end up with a war between the Martells, the Dornish people, and Darkstar and
stuff. I mean, we've got so in the books, spoilers everything, I mean, you know, obviously don't listen to us, but in the books, the sample chapter of Winds of Winter has Arianne running up to Storm's End to go meet Fake Aegon.
That's right.
And ally with him. Now, if he doesn't exist, and Arianne doesn't even exist in the show, does she? We didn't see her.
I don't think we see her. Yeah. I don't remember.
Once I started hearing, oh, hey, Susie, are you going to eat some of our strawberry cups? I don't think so.
I don't think she can, because chocolate could kill her, right?
Yeah, we're not going to let you eat that. But, what was I going to say? Yeah, so Arianne, she is hugely important to the plot, and if she's not even in Dorne, like, I can't even begin to deal with... I have no idea what they're doing.
Yeah.
I can't speak with any authority whatsoever
about
what it is that they've got
I do think,
going on
I
about Dorne.
I do definitely think that Dorne Martell is going to get murdered.
Oh, yeah.
I think that's absolutely going to happen.
I don't know that he's going to get murdered. I think he might die. Obviously, George likes killing people, so probably he'll get murdered. But I imagined that Aerya Hota was going to get killed by Obara Sand. I think that Obara, who's off hunting down Darkstar, is probably... I think that there's a chance she might join Darkstar, because they both kind of want... to kill things. What do you see, Susie?
She sees a reflection of your phone when you turn.
Oh.
And so
she's
obsessed. She's obsessed with
Susie is pacing back and forth across the double desks.
She's obsessed with things.
Hey, hey, hey.
Hey, hey, hey.
We just took a little quick time out.
Yeah, don't tell anyone.
Yeah, we're good at doing this show live. Ready? What's the next? Okay. So what's the next answer?
Oh.
So, top answers to what are the major differences between the show and the book. You got the North, which encompasses Davos, Stannis, all the
Night's Watchmen. And I got Dorne.
Yeah, and Dorne.
Okay.
Now what else? There's more on the list.
I guess King's Landing. Does that count as a third one with Jaime and Cersei?
Actually, it does, but it wasn't on our. It wasn't on my list.
Not on the list. Okay, okay.
And that is different, but I can't comment on it because I have no idea what they're doing with Jaime and Cersei being together since. In the book, they're totally separated.
Marjorie Tyrell is still in prison.
Oh, you only get one more strike, Dave. Uh-oh. And then it passes to me, and I already know all the answers.
Yeah, it's just cheating. You can't automatically steal.
What is the difference between the show and the book? Bonus points if you can pick what's in the stupidest pile or what's in the okay, that's cool. That's a cool change column.
Oh, ow.
this warlock, wine of the warlocks is
this
not
is
making
bad
us
for
smart.
Us.
It's
yeah,
not making
this
us
is,
smarter.
No, we're.
I feel like we're going into a fugue state.
I feel like we're quickly deteriorating this cast, but.
Just be our brains.
Could be our. It is a Friday.
Yeah.
So we're both kind of like in. It's Friday.
Tana's going to ring in and steal one and say,
right,
Ramsay Snow.
Oh. Yeah, that's a good one.
He's the worst. Do you know why? Because they gave him a fucking girlfriend. What?
Well, I mean, they did, but then he's just like, feed her to the dogs.
That was hilarious,
so,
actually.
Mean,
that should have been on the funniest
So
parts.
It's like the maester's like,
that's hilarious.
Should I have the men dig a grave or build a pyre, perhaps?
She's good meat.
She's good meat. Feed her to the dogs.
So this is my problem with that. So in the book, Ramsay is a complete sociopath, and his only feelings are, like, rage and, I don't know, whatever psychopaths feel. But it's not, like, love or warmth or emotion or care for any living thing. Not anything. I mean, at all. And so to give this guy a girlfriend and have him have a little sadistic... I don't know, but it humanizes him in a way that I think goes against the foundation of his character in the book, and so that irritates me, because it humanizes this monster.
Yeah, I guess.
And that just irks me. It's just sort of like, you know, sandpaper on the skin kind of irritation. Mm. So I hated that. So that was one. Now if you can get one more, there are three choices left,
ooh,
but if you get even one of them, you'll win the game! Feud of Thrones!
Isn't that technically a Game of Thrones? Because it's all just a feud.
It is. So
you know?
I kept telling Kirsten that this was going to be Game of Feuds.
Yeah.
And I was like, Game of Feuds! And she's like, Tana, you don't want to focus on the game part of it. You got to focus on the thrones part of it.
Yeah.
Feud of Thrones.
She's a smart one.
Like, yeah, she's clever.
Yeah.
And I was like, why don't you come over and then you and Dave can be on opposite sides. And
yeah, that
like,
would have been good.
She was like, hail to the no.
I don't want to hang out with that dude.
She would love to hang out with you. However, she hasn't seen the episode and she hates
Why didn't she? She should have came over on Sunday.
I know. I think, I don't know.
She doesn't want to hang out with me.
Mercury's in retrograde. Things are weird in the world right now, Dave. That's just truth.
I think she really just doesn't want to hang out with me. That's what it is.
I think Kirsten doesn't want to hang out with you.
Yeah.
I think it's you.
I think it's me.
Yeah.
Usually it is me.
It's definitely not that she wants a night of peace and quiet away from me. That is not what it's about at all.
I could definitely understand that.
That is not at all.
After just like a couple hours with you, I'm just like, all right,
you're
geez.
Like, oh, look at the time, Tana. Oh, let's
Tana,
wrap
let's
this
wrap.
Up.
I need that wrap it up box from the Chappelle show.
Totally
wrap it up. The podcast is getting long. Let's go. Let's get out of here. I'm giving up. I'm throwing in the towel.
One of three. You don't have any?
No, I
Come
can't.
Come on. What was a ridiculous thing? Do you remember what happened with Arya?
Oh, okay. The Arya fight on the steps outside.
A blind girl gets beaten up every day in the streets with a stick and nobody bats a fucking eyelash?
You know, an interesting thing happened.
What the fuck is that?
The interesting thing happened. Some rumor mill posted a gif of Cereal Pharrell like flipping his swords.
Is that Cereal?
Like, that well,
the double sword guy?
Yeah. It's Cereal in earlier in seasons,
oh,
right?
Oh, okay.
Right? And so he flips.
Because in the trailer, we had a double sword guy, right? But we thought it was maybe somebody in Dorne.
No, that's at the Tower of Joy.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, no. I'm talking about someone posted online a gif of Cyril Forel flipping double swords, like when he's, I think that scene is when he's protecting Arya, and he's like fighting like four people at once, including, and then gets killed by Meryn Trant.
Not sure in the books. Here's another difference: whether or not Cyril Forel is dead.
Well, we don't know if he's dead. We don't know if he's dead.
We didn't see him.
We don't know if he's dead in the show either. They also did that. They cut that scene.
He was just outnumbered, and it wasn't looking good for him.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Okay.
And so someone posted online that, you know, there's this coincidence where Arya is being protected by Cyril Forel. They do a double flip, and then when she's about to get beaten up in the streets as a blind girl, the waif does a double flip with these sticks.
Oh, so and we think that maybe they're trying to do some visual connection.
They're absolutely trying to do. I mean, this is something that directors like key on, right? So they're absolutely doing, like, I don't know if it's a throwback.
But I feel like anything that the show's doing, it's like it vaguely has something to do with Arya, and so we'll just repeat something that happened with Arya. But but what is actually happening there, like Syrio and the Faceless Men are not necessarily
the same people. No, definitely not.
They could be enemies.
But they are definitely both, they were definitely both trying to impart some wisdom on Arya. Yeah. So it's kind of like, I think that's the
callback.
A callback, yeah.
So Arya's masters of weaponry or whatever.
And life and
they're gonna
death
beat the crap out. I just love that nobody batted an eye. It's like it happens every day, and some chick just shows up and beats the shit out of a blind girl, and nobody gives a fuck.
I feel like people there in Braavos are just like, some weird fucking shit's happening. Could be faceless men. Let's not
just
get involved.
Look away,
Let's
look
not
away.
Get involved.
Because in the book, this happens in one of the cellars, or you know, in the not citadel, but whatever the house of the black and white.
Yeah.
And so it's in one of the chambers, and she's doing her chores,
and
then
she
suddenly
gets hit.
She gets hit by a stick, and so it's trying to teach her to use all her senses. And it's a great scene. It's not a blind girl getting the shit kicked out of her in the street, which was hilarious.
But it was so like, that's like real quick. I'm sure next episode they're going to touch a lot more on Arya and stuff like that, or maybe just for like a couple episodes. Imagine if just for a couple episodes they just quickly flash Arya getting hit with a stick, and then that's it. And they go back.
Just remember that she exists. Whack! Or taking a punch or something.
Yeah, right.
She's just always gonna
like in the sixth or seventh episode of the season towards the end, they'll do like a whole episode on Arya. But like until then,
she's
they're just like
snap
they're just
the
a snap getting hit with a stick, and that's it. I can never be a show director because I would do stupid shit like that. Just like, hey, we're not going to talk about Arya this episode. Let's just show we're getting hit with a stick.
I'm going to steal the last one, and this will be the last time I play our little theme music. Jorah and Dario are buddies. Like, what the fuck is this buddy like cop
they're like,
comedy
we
happening?
Both love Khaleesi, so we're going to hunt her down.
True Detective Jorah style? Like,
yeah, okay. I can see that.
Jorah
and Dario. Picks up the ring. He's like, get the CSI team.
What was that? Needle in a haystack
Okay, look, come on.
We watched it together. You saw me, and I was like, shut the fuck up.
And I explained it to
you. That.
I explained it to you. They see the circle. There's a target on the ground. Okay? And let's be honest. Like,
stupid.
They could have been there for 20 minutes, but they're not going to fucking show them searching the grass for 20 minutes.
That's a fair point.
So
it's a
show.
They have to do these things.
Yeah. In the book, it could have been very easy. Yeah. They searched the grass for 4 hours.
Except it would
and
never
then found
happen because the book would never have Dario and Jorah buddying up. Jorah hates Dario. Plus, Dario is still a hostage, and he isn't free, and the Yunkai might kill him. So we don't know what's going to happen with him. But that was that's Feud of Thrones, Dave. What do you think of our new segment?
I like it, but I
next
think
next time we have a guest, I'll put together like a whole bigger.
I think we should try to get other people's to vote.
Yeah.
I don't know how because people like
we're not
popular.
The last time I did a poll, 10 people answered it I started driving over to your house. So that wasn't the most encouraging thing.
I mean. We can maybe let it simmer for a little while.
Let's percolate on some ideas.
Yeah, we can reach out to some people.
If we had Eric from Kickball, or if we had another guest then they could ring in. It could be, you know, about a show or something. And then top five answers, which are really just answers that I thought of. Or maybe if we do a poll.
True.
But then you could cheat and look at the poll. We're going to have to sort out the rules.
All right.
And then, which brings us to the last and final thing.
Oh, there's more? I thought that was the end.
I know, but I wanted to play it again. It's kind of catchy. The end.
Go home, Steve Harvey, you're drunk.
The fucking end. Melisandre.
The reveal.
We got to talk about this. That's what we got to talk about. Our episode's called The Red Woman.
Okay,
who
so
is
it's.
She? What
it's,
the fuck?
It's clearly.
WTF, man.
Well, wait, what was the episode called? The episode was called The Red Woman, right? Wasn't it?
No, it was called something that made people think Jon Snow was going to get resurrected.
I thought it was called The Red Woman.
Was it? I don't know. You know the show. You're the show guy.
It was called The Red Woman.
Yeah.
What, ready?
Well, maybe they thought that The Red Woman was going to resurrect Jon?
Okay, Google.
Oh, shit.
What was the first episode of Game of Thrones called?
Oh, no. Of season 6.
Oh, of season 6. Oh, shit.
Nope.
Cortana,
or whatever
that is
isn't going to get
gonna
it now.
It's fucked it up.
You did not set your robot up for success.
I did not. I felt...
What kind of an engineer are you?
One that
one is drinking too much Shade of the Evening.
Shade of the Evening.
Turns out, guys, Shade of the Evening makes
the
you
Red
real
Woman.
Dumb.
It was called The Red Woman.
Was
See?
It?
Yes, it was.
Well, then look at us.
Episode 2 is called Home.
So ours is called The Red Woman. Who is The Red Woman? And it's about The Red Woman.
It's
look
about
at
The Red
that.
Woman. So,
parody, my friends.
So here it is.
We are topical. We are informative.
We are drunk.
Nothing if not entertaining. All men must
drink.
Shade of the Evening, guys. Blue Curacao, red wine, and cider.
Surprise! Like, I'm not drunk, but surprisingly, I'm feeling very loopy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep. I feel it. And it has a nice sort of flavor to it. Oh, I wanted to read. Can I get in there, Susie? I want to see if I can get the description.
Of Shade of the Evening.
Shade of the Evening.
Well, let's not switch topics now. Let's talk about The Red Woman.
Okay, but I already have it, because this is what we're drinking. So everyone at home, this is why we're rambling and disjointed tonight, because we were drinking Shade of the Evening. One flute, said Pyat Pree, will serve only to unstop your ears and dissolve the call from off your eyes, so that you may hear and see the truths that will be laid before you. Dany raised the glass to her lips. The first sip tasted like ink and spoiled meat. Ugh.
That tastes way better than ink and spoiled meat.
Foul. But when she swallowed it, it seemed to come to life within her. She could feel tendrils spreading through her chest like fingers of fire coiling around her heart.
Uh-oh.
And on her tongue was a taste like honey and anise and cream. Like mother's milk and Drogo's seed, like red meat.
Like
and
Drogo's seed, yeah. Wow, she's been doing a little...
like red meat. There's also the hand gesture to go along with that, friends at home. Like mother's milk and Drogo's seed, like red meat and hot blood and molten gold. It was all the tastes she had ever known, and none of them. And now, and then, the glass was empty. Cheers!
Almost, our glasses are almost empty. We might have to make some more.
Isn't that one of the best descriptions of, like, the taste of something? It's that, and weirwood paste was described very much like that.
Yeah.
I just think, you know, as our podcast is about drinking and Game of Thrones, we gotta always, like, tuck that stuff in when we drink.
I agree. It was a great,
you know,
description.
I mean? Like, this I don't know
what
Cal
Drogo's seed tastes like, but...
Neither do I, Dave. All men must drink.
All men must drink.
So the Red Woman. Here we are with the Red Woman. Let's pause it real quick and refill our
time to
the
refill
evening.
the drinks.
Yeah.
Drinks are full. We got full drinks.
Full drinks.
God, when did I start singing? Oh God, I really
Shade
am getting
loopy. Shade of
the
Evening is opening your mind.
Open.
It is it is uncowling your eyes or whatever. Dissolving the cowl on your
eyes. And it tastes like
Khal
Drogo's seed.
Gets better every time. That's what
God.
She said.
That's what she said.
So, where were we? Melisandre. Who is this red woman? So, end of the show comes.
Okay, so for those of you who don't read the books, right, this is kind of a big reveal.
Yeah.
Because
we don't know that this is true. We suspected, a careful reader would have suspected that Melisandre was older than she appeared and that maybe there was a glamour happening. The most obvious one for me was that if she is a priestess of the Red Temple, she should have a face tattoo. That's the most obvious one for me.
But there was, she, even when she was old, she doesn't have a face tattoo.
So she has no face tattoos. What's up with that? But anyway, I mean, maybe that's a small thing, but...
Maybe she's more than just a priestess of the Red Temple. Maybe she is, like, the priestess of the Red Temple.
But if she's the priestess, she's getting a shit ton of things wrong. Okay, so...
Well, but to be fair, she does make the comment that it's the... What we see in the flames isn't necessarily wrong. It's our interpretation of them.
However, we have two other Red Priests that we see, Bonaro and then Makaro in the books. Yeah. Makaro's with Victarion.
Thoros as well.
With Thoros, that's right. And Thoros is more adept at reading and bringing fucking zombies back to life than Melisandre.
Truth.
So we've got, she's like, if we're weighing all of the Red Priests and Priestesses, Melisandre's competency is like way at the bottom of the pile.
True.
So this idea that she's 4 million years old and is the queen of all Rolorists seems flimsy to me, based on the fact that she's terrible at her job.
So how old do you think she is, then?
So that's the question. I think she's probably 120.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's what I would say. No, I don't know. Not 120. Maybe in her 80s, I would think. I don't know, but I have an idea of who... So there's a fan theory that I would like us to talk about.
All right, let's do it.
And it's been all the buzz all over the internet about her being the child. So in the show, I can't speak to, because I don't know what they're doing in the show. I have no idea what their plan is, but I can speak with some measure of authority about the books, and I'm going to bring some ideas to you. I want to present the fan theory that Melisandre is the love child of Bloodraven, the three-eyed crow, who's with Bran right now, and his half-sister, Shiera Seastar. Okay? And there's some proofs for that, and so I've assembled some stuff, but first maybe we can listen to this really awesome audio clip of Melisandre having a night vision where she actually sees the three-eyed crow. So I want you guys to be listening for a couple of things during this clip, okay? First of all, it's awesome. My boy Roy Dotrice is totally reading the shit out of it. but
reading
she sees
the shit.
But Melisandre's looking in the flames. She wants to see Stannis, and she actually sees Bloodraven and Bran, although she doesn't recognize them. And there are a ton of symbols and foreshadowing. Dragons, death, Jon Snow. And if you listen very carefully, you can hear my two birds, Lady Bird and Larry Bird, chirping in the background.
And remember, this is from the books.
This is from the books. So if you guys watch the show only and you're wondering, like, what do the books say about her? Well, this is going to give you a pretty good idea. Okay, here we go.
One more time. She had to be certain. Many a priest and priestess before her had been brought down by false visions, by seeing what they wished to see instead of what the Lord of Light had said. Stannis was marching south into peril, the king who carried the fate of the world upon his shoulders, Azor Ahai reborn. Surely R'hllor would vouchsafe her a glimpse of what awaited him. Show me Stannis, Lord, she prayed. Show me your king, your instrument. Visions danced before her, gold and scarlet, flickering, forming and melting, and dissolving into one another, shapes strange and terrifying and seductive. She saw the eyeless faces again, staring out at her from sockets weeping blood. Then the towers by the sea, crumbling as the dark tide came sweeping over them, rising from the depths. Shadows in the shape of skulls, skulls that turned to mist, bodies locked together in lust, writhing and rolling and clawing, to curtains of fire, great winged shadows wheeled against a hard blue sky.
Maybe.
The girl, I must find the girl again, the grey girl on the dying horse. Jon Snow would expect that of her, and so it would not be enough to say the girl was fleeing.
Well,
he would want more. He would want the when and where, and she did not have that for him. A face took shape within the hearth. Stannis, she thought, just for a moment. But no, these were not his features. A wooden face, corpse white. Was this the enemy? A thousand red eyes floated in the rising flames. He sees me. Beside him, a boy with a wolf's face threw back his head and howled. The red priestess shuddered. Blood trickled down her thigh, black and smoking. The fire was inside her, an agony, an ecstasy, filling her, searing her, transforming her. Shimmers of heat traced patterns on her skin, insistent as a lover's hand. Strange voices called to her from days long past. Melanie, she heard a woman cry. A man's voice called, Lot 7. She was weeping, and her tears were flame, and still she drank it in. Snowflakes swirled from a dark sky, and ashes rose to meet them, the gray and the white whirling around each other as flaming arrows arced above a wooden wall, and dead things shambled silent through the cold, beneath a great gray cliff where fires burned inside 100 caves. Then the wind rose, and the white mist came sweeping in, impossibly cold, and one by one, the fires went out. Afterward, only the skulls remained. Death, thought Melisandre. The skulls are death.
So that's Melisandre and that famous Melanie Lot 7 fire vision scene. Read wonderfully by Roy Dotrice. If you guys have a ton of time and you want to listen to 40,000 hours of Game of Thrones books, I highly recommend you buy them. But yeah, so that's her vision, dude. What the fuck? So she sees Bloodraven.
So it's there's a couple interesting things there.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Definitely one that she sees Bloodraven and that Bloodraven sees him back.
He sees her. And she's like, is this the enemy? What if it's her dad? Right? What if he's been watching her? But like her reaction to that, her body's reaction, is to bleed her black putrid blood. What the fuck? What the fuck is that, George? What are you doing?
Well,
what the fuck is that?
Well, maybe it's just her period.
She sees Bloodraven and Bran, and then black blood leaks out of her. What? So that's a thing that happens.
So not only does that happen, but we get this interesting scene of her memory. Well, we think it's her memory.
It's her memory, right? Melanie, Lot 7. That sounds like a slave market.
That absolutely sounds like a slave market. She's crying.
So the line is this. She was weeping and her tears were flame.
Yeah.
Right? So maybe she's 7 years old or whatever and she's crying because she's being sold as a slave and they're tattooing flames on her.
Mm.
So she's crying and then the tears are also flames. Now, granted, I could just be inventing all of this face tattoo stuff, but Makoro...
You're obsessed with the whole
Makoro
face tattoo.
Makoro has those face tattoos and he looks like a flame. Like, he looks like a black flame. Is how he's described, and the tattoos on his face seem to shimmer and writhe. And it says in the world book that they tattoo slaves' faces, and that Red R'hllor gets flames tattooed on their face. So there's some basis for me to think that Melisandre would have that, and the line is, she was weeping and her tears were flame. So, I mean, I don't know, man, but...
Sounds pretty good to me.
Yeah.
So the question is, then how does she get captured? How does she become a slave if she's the daughter of Shiera Seastar and Bloodraven?
So we got to talk about Shiera, don't we? We
got
to talk about Shiera and Bloodraven.
We do.
That's the next step.
Lay it on us.
All right. So who are her parents? Bloodraven. What do we know about Bloodraven?
We know that he's a Targaryen.
Targaryen.
We know that he is a powerful wizard.
Yeah. He is.
I mean, I'm
he's a tree.
Being honest.
Right now, he's a tree.
Right now, he's a tree.
He's got one eye.
He's got thousands of eyes.
He's got a thousand eye and one.
And one.
And he only has... So, let me consult my notes. Let's try to keep on track here.
All right.
Oh,
yeah, we're already at the 48-minute mark. I may have to bring out the wrap it up soon.
No, we're going to go a little bit long tonight, I think. It was because we played such a fun game earlier, said Tana, who forced Dave to play a game against his will every
said
time.
Tana, who just likes to stump Dave.
I realized that I downloaded the audiobook for Duncan Egg, like the entire Night of the Seven Kingdoms, which is wonderful. So we have another reader that's going to be reading us this description of Bloodraven.
Is he as good as Royce Dutrice?
You're going to have to make up your own mind.
Oh.
And this is...
Finally, I get my own opinion. Yeah,
this is from the Mystery Knight. So it's a
description... Wait, but what is this? A description of Bloodraven?
It's a description of Bloodraven that from Dunk, and Dunk is like remembering what he looked like. So this is while Bloodraven is alive and a young man, or, you know, like an alive human dude.
Not a tree.
Not a tree.
How many eyes does Lord Bloodraven have? The riddle ran, 1,000 eyes and 1. Some claimed the king's hand was a student of the dark arts who could change his face, put on the likeness of a one-eyed dog, even turn into a mist.
Famous.
Packs of gaunt gray wolves hunted down his foes, men said, and carrion crows spied for him and whispered secrets in his ear. Most of the tales were only tales, Dunk did not doubt. But no one could doubt that Bloodraven had informers everywhere. He had seen the man once with his own 2 eyes, back in King's Landing, white as bone with the skin and hair of Brynden Rivers. And his eye, he only had the one, the other having been lost to his half-brother Bittersteel on the Redgrass Field, was red as blood. On cheek and neck, he bore the wine-stained birthmark that had given him his name. When the town was well behind them, Dunk cleared his throat and said, "Our business, cut off the heads of septons.
They had seen a septon that had been murdered.
Words are wind. Some words are wind, sir. Some are treason." Egg was skinny as a stick, all ribs and elbows, but he did have a mouth.
Which is cute, but he did have a mouth. So that's from Dunk and Egg the Mystery Knight, and Dunk is remembering seeing him. And there's a part a little bit later that says he was wearing Dark Sister on his hip as well, because he has the Targaryen sword Dark Sister. So, going in our way back machine.
No, it's more like it's not boodly doop.
Bloodraven is kind of scrawny. He has 1 red eye and 1 hole missing from his face. He doesn't really wear a patch. He likes showing his missing eye off. He has long white hair.
Kind of makes him a badass. Like, I lost my eye.
Yep.
Sup, dog?
And he has a wine-stained birthmark that vaguely is reminiscent of a raven. But it's just sort of a wine-stained birthmark.
Yeah.
He's obviously a warg.
Yep.
His favorite animals are, I would guess, ravens. He called his archer buddies the Raven's Teeth, and so I would think. But he also, there was rumors he turned into a dog, a one-eyed dog, wolves, stuff like that. He's albino. He was the Hand of the King. He was the Lord Commander of the Night's Watch. He was hated in his own time. That clip that we heard was about a septon who was preaching against Bloodraven, talking about what a warlock and a wizard and a terrible, like...
Dude, yeah, people blame the spring sickness on him. They blamed a lot of things on him. He
was a kinslayer.
He's absolutely hated. People feared and hated Bloodraven.
In his own time, he was feared and hated, but he was also ruling the kingdom. Daemon Blackfyre, who started the Blackfyre Rebellions, think of him as like Marvel's Thor, but without a beard. So, you know, very charming, very handsome, the warrior incarnate. He has 7 sons, so the faith thinks that he's super holy.
Right.
Blackfyre Rebellions, he rises up with his half-brother Bittersteel. So it goes, let me think about this. Daemon is the oldest, then Bloodraven, is that right? And then Bittersteel. Or no, it's Bittersteel first. He's older than Bloodraven. But Bloodraven has, like, middle child syndrome. No, Bittersteel has middle child syndrome.
Yeah.
That's how
pay attention to me, pay attention to me. I'm going to cut your eye out.
Yeah, and Aegon the Unworthy had so many, like, mistresses that Brynden Rivers, who is Bloodraven, his mom displaced Aegor Rivers, which is Bittersteel's mom. So he was old enough as a kid to hate Bloodraven because he got displaced for him.
Yeah.
So let's see. Bittersteel poked his eye out during the Redgrass Field. He's a kinslayer. He killed his brother, his half-brother, Daemon Blackfyre, and his nephews, the eldest twin sons of his brother, Daemon.
Some also claim that he had a hand in killing a whole bunch of others to put Mr. Egg on the throne.
That's right.
Which we covered in previous episodes.
on your world book, there's some history of him. He was born the bastard child of King Aegon the Unworthy and his mistress, Melissa Blackwood. Hmm. So the Brackens and the Blackwoods hate each other. Well, Aegor Rivers was a Bracken, and he was, you know, his mom was displaced by the Blackwoods. He was born in 175 after conquest. He has two sisters nobody ever talks about, Maya and Gwenys, G-W-E-N-Y-S.
Gwenys? Spelled again?
G-W-E-N-Y-S. Gwenys. That's it. Gwenys. I don't know.
Gwenys.
Maya and Gwenys.
Gwenys?
Yeah, his mom was with his dad for 5 years. She was a mistress the whole time.
Someone tell us how to pronounce that name.
King Aegon is married to his sister the whole time.
Well, that's Targaryen, yeah. Just Targaryen in general.
So, during the time of Duncan Egg, Bloodraven served as the Hand of the King, and it was the King Aerys, but it was the first King Aerys, not the Mad King Aerys. It was Aerys the Virgin. And it was a super shitty time to be king. Like you said, there was the Spring Sickness. Dagon Greyjoy, who's Theon's granddad, had risen up in rebellion and was raiding all along that coast of Westeros.
What is dead may never die.
Yep. He was mid-rebellion. Bittersteel was plotting rebellion with the five remaining sons of Daemon Blackfyre. And then a drought, which we saw in the last Duncan Egg story, mm-hmm. The Hedge Knight.
That's right.
A drought that would have lasted more than 2 years and pushed the realm towards starvation and fire and all this stuff was all happening during Aerys the Virgin's reign while Brynden Rivers Bloodraven was the Hand. And so there was like, it was a super shitty time to be in charge.
Yeah. Pretty shitty. So the question is, do we think Mr. Raven of Blood is a good guy or a bad guy?
I like him.
Yeah?
But I think everybody's got those gray areas. I mean, he did kill his brothers and his kin. I think he loved his brother Daemon, but he killed him when he rose in rebellion. And then he probably always wished that he could kill Bittersteel.
True.
Yeah. Quote, Bloodraven proved to be a capable hand, but also a master of whisperers who rivaled Lady Misery. And there were those that thought he and his half-sister and paramour, Shiera Seastar, used sorcery to ferret out secrets. It became common to refer to his, quote, thousand eyes in one, and men both high and low began to distrust their neighbor for fear of there being a spy in Bloodraven's employ. World Book, page 104. Now, we know that he got a lot of his secrets probably from face changing, because there's a bit of that in the Duncan Egg stories, and also from being a warg, right? Like, if he's in the Ravens, and he's, like, parked outside you and your friend talking treason, he's gonna know.
Yeah.
And so, there was a lot of mistrust, because he knew things he shouldn't. And also, his sister, half-sister and paramour, Shiera Seastar. Paramour means lover.
Paramour means bout chicka wow wow.
Yep.
Hey, sister, soul sister.
People fucking hate it.
Will you be my love sister? Hey, sister, soul sister. You're my Shiera Seastar sister.
But dudes hated this guy.
Yeah.
So here's the Septon. This is what the Septon had been saying
of
about
Bloodraven. Of course dudes hated him. He's getting some and he's knows everything about everyone.
Yeah.
His hands are scarlet with a brother's blood and the blood of his young nephews, too.
This is the Septon.
Had declared to the crowd that had gathered in the market square. A shadow came at his command to strangle Prince Velar's sons in their mother's womb.
Sounds a little bit like Red Velour.
Where is our young prince now?
Yep.
Where is his brother, sweet Materis? Where is good King Daeron gone, and fearless Baelor Breakspear?
Smash
him. The grave has claimed them, everyone, yet he endures. This pale bird with bloody beak who perches on King Aerys' shoulder and caws into his ear. The mark of hell is on his face and in his empty eye, and he has brought us drought and pestilence and murder. Rise up, I say, and remember our true king across the water. Seven gods there are, and 7 kingdoms, and the black dragon sired 7 sons. Rise up, my lords and ladies, rise up, you brave knights and sturdy yeomen, and cast down Bloodraven, the foul sorcerer, lest your children and your children's children be cursed forevermore.
And then he gets chopped off.
Exactly.
So, and then it was a shock to see him here, with holes where his eyes had been.
Yep, so that's what's going to happen to you if you preach treason. So those are the kind of things that people are saying about him as he's Hand of the King.
Yeah, people
and
don't like him.
They're like, so that's just a sample of the kind of shit talk that was happening in the Seven Kingdoms during his reign.
That's some pretty smackdown. Like,
that is.
That's like, hey bitches, you a sucker. Yeah.
He made it his life's work. He hates the Blackfyre rebellions.
Yes.
And he made it his life's work. So Bloodraven, yeah, to tear them down. Even though his brother gave them pardon. And I think, let me see here. He sacrificed his own honor to trick Aenys Blackfyre into coming over for the Great Council of 233 AC, only to arrest the kid and chop his head off as soon as he landed in King's Landing. Quote,
like, hey, come on back, yep. Mr. Blackfyre. We're gonna talk and make nice with you. Oh, you came over? Chopped your head off.
And he promised him safe passage. Come make your claim to the Great Council. We're trying to figure out who should rule us. You know, King Aerys, the virgin, never consummated his marriage and didn't leave us any heirs.
So we need
come
to pick
and let's
someone.
Check this out. Yep.
So come and we'll figure it out.
Yep.
Oh, you showed up.
They ultimately choose Maekar. No, they ultimately choose Egg, I mean.
Yeah.
But this is the Great Council where they try to offer it to Aemon. What's his name? Maester Aemon, secretly.
Aemon.
Yep, because nobody wants Egg to be the ruler because he's like half a commoner.
Yep.
Quote, the first act of Egg/Aegon's The Unlikely's reign was, quote, to have Bloodraven arrested for the murder of Aenys Blackfyre. Bloodraven did not deny that he had lured the pretender into his power by the offer of a safe conduct, but contended that he had sacrificed his own personal honor for the good of the realm. World Book, page 107. So, this is how he ends up getting shipped off to the Night's Watch. It's 233, and he was like, so ends the Blackfyre Rebellions. I did what was good for the realm. Send me to the wall with Aemon Targaryen. Off we go. La-di-da.
And while he's there, he becomes Lord Commander.
He's there. Yeah, he gets shipped up in 233. He becomes Lord Commander in 239. And here's the quote from the World Book. Bloodraven would rise to become Lord Commander of the Night's Watch in 239 AC, serving until his disappearance during arranging beyond the wall in 252 AC.
So he was Lord Commander for a long-ass time.
He rose to be Lord Commander when he was 58. He left for the wall. At age 77, he heads off into the lands beyond the wall. So, and if the age now is 300 after conquest, then that makes Brynden Rivers, Bloodraven, 125. Is that right? Yeah, because he was born in 175.
Do we have to do some quick calculating?
We might, and it's the year 300. What's 300 minus 175? 125.
125.
It's not 225, it's
125,
right?
Yeah, 125.
Okay, so he's 125, so that's not like super old.
Yeah, I'm an engineer. I had to do math on a calculator because just saying.
Because what is it? Shade of the evening.
Shade of the evening.
Drink.
Oh my, Tana. I mean, I was definitely drunker for.
All men must drink.
Hold on, I'm talking here. Okay, I'm sorry. All men must drink.
Mm-hmm. It's a good damn drink.
I was definitely drunker for old Nan's Edward 40. Yeah. Edward Neddard. Neddard 40 hands. But
he only had, well, I guess it was a lot of beer, but still.
Yeah.
It's not wine and cider.
I'm on my third glass of this.
Am I a numero dos?
Yes. You're at two.
I think I'm on dose.
You're at two, but you also have to drive home.
I know. That's
potentially
true. That's true. We're gonna hang out for a while.
You can crash in the guest room if you really need to.
Well, I might just talk your ear off on Game of Thrones all night and you'll have to throw me out into the street.
I'm gonna get the wrap it up button again.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Is that, what does it sound like?
I forget.
Wrap it up. No, that doesn't
it's just some music and it just flashes. It plays people out. It plays people out like the Oscars. Like, okay. Get off my stage. Get out of my house.
So if Bloodraven had his sister as his paramour, what do we know about Melisandre's mom, Shiera Seastar?
Well,
do you know anything about her?
I don't know anything about her.
Do you even know her name?
Shiera Seastar.
Ding! I mean, where's my sound effect?
Name the top one answer of what is Shiera Seastar's name?
Yeah, we're going to have to do Jeopardy. We'll have to do like...
Who is Shiera Seastar?
Yeah, it's Celebrity Jeopardy instead. Hey, there's our train! I love our train.
What up, the train?
Shiera Seastar is the daughter of King Aegon the Unworthy.
Yeah.
And his very last mistress, Sereni. Sereni? S-E-R-E-N-E-I.
Sereni.
Sereni of Lys.
Almost like Serenity.
And it says...
And Firefly.
It says this about her. Quote, a Lycian beauty from an ancient but impoverished line, brought to court by Lord John Hightower, the new hand. Sereni was the most beautiful of Aegon's mistresses, but she was also reputed to be a sorceress. She died giving birth to the last of the king's bastards, a girl called Shiera Seastar, who became the greatest beauty in the Seven Kingdoms, beloved of both her half-brothers, Bittersteel, Aegor Rivers, who was born in either 172 or 173, and Bloodraven, who was born in 175, whose rivalry would ripen to hatred. That's in your rule book on page 99.
So, her mother was a sorcerer.
Yeah, and a beauty.
And a beauty. She's even more beautiful.
She's from Lys. She's a Lycian beauty.
Oh,
from
so she definitely
house.
Knows how to
you
get
know,
Khal Drogo's seed.
Well, yeah, but if she's Lyseni from an ancient and impoverished house of Valyrian blood,
she could have an X gene.
She could have an X gene. Hold on.
Could she have an X gene?
Lady Shiera. So, thus spoke Martin, or whatever it is, March 7th, 2006. It says this. He was giving notes to the artists for the world book.
Okay.
And because they have to make people look a certain way. And so there's an illustration in here of Sereni, and she has purple eyes and the golden sort of, she's very Targaryen looking. She's Lyseni, but she looks like a Targaryen. And it says, Lady Shiera, so
the
possibly
daughter.
Melisandre's mom.
Correct.
Was the natural daughter of King Aegon IV by his last mistress, Lady Sereni of Lys, the last daughter of an ancient but impoverished line of Valyrian nobility. In the court, she was considered cold and haughty, and some said that she was much older than the king and preserved her beauty by the practice of dark arts. Considered by many the
sounds
most...
Sounds like someone
right?
else we know.
Right?
Ding, 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 ding.
Considered by many the most lovely of Aegon's mistresses, sweet Sereni died in childbed, bringing forth the last of the great king of the king's great bastards, the daughter that she named Shiera Star of the Sea. So that's March 7th, 2006 on Thus Spoke Gurm. And that's her mom. So she, Bloodraven, and Bittersteel all loved each other and were in like some, I don't know.
Love triangle. Feud.
But Bloodraven and her were paramours, it says in the world book. So it's possible that they had a child and that that child was sold into slavery.
Is it,
how any of
do
that
we think
might
it's possible
happened,
that Melisandre could be Shiera Seastar? Probably not.
Maybe, but so we had our old Nan episode.
Yeah.
And it makes way more sense for old Nan to be Shiera Seastar. Because if Bloodraven and her stayed
so
in touch.
So she's not Rayon Weber anymore?
I know. She's not old Ronan.
Ronan? She's not... She's not an old Ronan anymore.
All men must drink.
All men must drink.
Not old Ronan. Yeah.
Okay, so now we think that she's Shiera Seastar.
Yeah. So
which is interesting because why wouldn't she then just can make herself beautiful?
So here's what we know about Shiera Seastar.
Okay.
Shiera, this is again, thus spoke Gurm, that same time frame. Shiera was born with one dark blue eye and one bright green one, but the singer said that this flaw only accentuated her loveliness. So this is Melisandre's mom,
okay.
We're thinking. Or possibly old Nan, we don't know. Continuing.
Probably more like Melisandre's mom. I'm already seeing some similarities there, obviously, so.
She was the greatest beauty of her age, a slender and elegant woman, slim of waist and full of breast. Ooh. She had the silver gold hair of the Targaryens,
Kittas.
Thick and curling, and wore it very long. At some points in her life, it fell well below her waist, almost to the back of her knees. That's some seriously long hair, yo.
That's some hair.
She had a heart-shaped
face. Very unlike
face.
Your hair.
Yeah, mine is very short.
Yeah, shorter than mine, I think.
Yeah,
maybe.
Shorter than Thor's, maybe. Definitely.
Maybe.
Not
okay.
Shorter than yours.
No.
But shorter than Thor's. She had a heart-shaped face, full lips, and her mismatched eyes were strangely large and full of mischief. Her rival said she used them to melt men's hearts. Even at an early age, she was a great reader. She spoke a dozen tongues and surrounded herself with ancient scrolls. Like her mother, she was reputed to practice the dark arts. Though she never wed, she had many offers and several lovers through the years. Duels were fought over the right to sit beside her, men killed themselves after falling from her favor, poets outdid each other writing songs about her beauty. We get it, George.
We get it, she's fucking hot.
Her most ardent admirer was her half-brother, Bloodraven, who proposed marriage to her 50 times. Shiera gave him her bed, but never her hand. It amused her more to make him jealous. And then this is the note to the artist. As for how to paint her, she was fond of ivory and lace and cloth of silver, but not gold, which she considered to be too vulgar. Her favorite piece of jewelry was a heavy silver necklace of emeralds and star sapphires alternating, which makes sense because her eyes are green and blue.
Right.
So emeralds and star sapphires, she's
going
to have a necklace of green and blue with silver. And so this is Shiera Seastar, possibly Melisandre's mom, with Bloodraven. Bloodraven is 6 feet tall. He's an albino. He's kind of scrawny. He's got one eye. Wears his hair long.
Yeah.
Those are her parents. So maybe, and go back, readers, listeners, and see how Melisandre is first described in Clash of Kings when we meet her. I think it says things like heart-shaped face, full lips, it's described like this in the chapter. She's introduced by what's his name, Cressen, Maester Cressen, as the Red Woman was at the heart of it. I don't know if that's like something dumb or if like the heart and the heart shaped face.
Yeah.
I don't know.
The flaming heart.
Yeah.
And the banners.
She's like, I don't know.
It definitely seems like she thinks that men will do anything for her beauty and love. Though, interestingly enough, a couple men in our story refuse her. Davos, John.
Melisandre, you mean?
Yeah, John.
Yeah, John refuses her.
You know?
She wants to make a shadow baby with John.
Yeah.
I have a clip about that.
Do you? Maybe. Do you want to play that clip?
It's a short one.
Shadow baby? Can I refill my drink?
Go refill your drink, Dave.
God.
You got nowhere to be.
This is so many. I'm not going to be able to stand later.
You're going to be a wise wizard.
The wisest of wizards.
You're going to be the warlockiest of wizards.
I am not a wolf, he told. And how would I do that? I can show you. Melisandre draped one slender arm over Ghost, and the dire wolf licked her face. The Lord of Light, in his wisdom, made us male and female, two parts of a greater whole. In our joining, there is power. Power to make life. Power to make light. Power to cast shadows. Shadows? The world seemed darker when he said it. Every man who walks the earth casts a shadow on the world. Some are thin and weak, others long and dark. You should look behind you, Lord Snow. The moon has kissed you and etched your shadow upon the ice 20 feet tall.
So that's Melisandre talking about John and making a shadow baby and how his shadow, like, he felt like the world got darker. So she's over here being like, Lord of Light, la la la, but she talks about shadows and suddenly everything gets super fucking cold and he has a giant shadow. Also, the moon kissed him? That could be Nessa Nessa.
Nessa Nessa.
Speaking of our, like, symbolism.
Symbolism,
episode,
yeah.
The moon kissed him and he rose 20 feet tall on the wall or some shit. So there's a lot of fun stuff in here, but it seems to me that probably, I mean, I think, I don't know if Melisandre is the love baby of Bloodraven and Shiera Seastar, but there's a case to be made that she is. I'm not convinced, but it's plausible. I wouldn't be surprised if she is.
So let's make the assumption that she is.
Yep.
What are the implications of that? Where does that bring us in the story? I think I ask this on almost every episode.
I know.
That you present us a theory. Like, what happens
next? I don't know. Here's more stuff I know. Well, what happens next? I still don't know. Here's more stuff.
So, I mean, you know, being the daughter, do we think Bloodraven knows? And if Bloodraven knows, when he looks at her in the fire, is that blood trying to tell her, trying to contact her?
No, it's gonna. You know? But there's definitely not a call and response. But there's definitely she sees him and starts bleeding black blood.
There's definitely a common magic here. I mean, Bloodraven clearly is like, oh shit.
Also,
she's looking
at me. He's a shadowbinder and a skin changer.
Yeah.
Like there was all those rumors in that clip I played from the Duncan Egg story about sending out a shadow to kill people.
Yeah,
or something.
Exactly.
Like that's some fucking Red R'hllor shit.
Yeah.
And
is Bloodraven Red R'hllor? Is Bloodraven the one?
But he's
who
an
is...
old gods guy. He's in the weirwoods. I don't think R'hllor and the old gods are the same, right? And he's definitely an old gods guy.
Yeah.
He's got the white
Unless,
of the weirwood,
you know,
and the red.
He's like L. Ron Hubbard, who said, if you want to get rich, start a religion.
Oh, well.
And he
Let's not isolate all of our is that Mormons?
It's Scientologists.
Damn it. Okay, well, let's not alienate all of our Scientologists that are definitely listening to
us. I don't think there are any Scientologists that are listening to us. But if you are, please tweet us and tell us that you are offended.
We hope that you're enjoying the podcast.
Please tell me that you're offended by my L. Ron Hubbard comment.
Let's see.
You got anything else for us, Tana?
Brendan Rivers is albino. He's got milk white skin, white hair. He's tall.
I think we got it.
Yeah.
The question, you know, the question we leave to you listeners.
You didn't know this. His sigil is a white dragon, one-headed, with red eyes. So
ice dragon?
In case any of you were wondering.
Ice dragon?
Could be an ice dragon. Although, it has red eyes, not blue eyes. So maybe a living ice dragon. I don't know. But that's his sigil, according to George, on December 26, 2005. In a note on the notable Targaryen bastards.
So he didn't have a red dragon?
He had a white dragon
or a black dragon?
What one-headed white dragon with two red eyes.
That it's one-headed, because all the Targaryens are three heads.
He's a shade under 6 feet tall, very thin, gaunt with a grim, unforbidding aspect and a sinister reputation as a sorcerer and spymaster. Although he bears the Valyrian steel blade Dark Sister that once belonged to Aegon's Visenya, his favorite weapon is a tall, bone-white, weirwood longbow. He's an expert bowman, and his bow is white. So, here's my question. Did Bloodraven take Dark Sister north with him to the Wall? Now, we don't know. There's no way for us to know. But
it's safe to assume that he did.
I assume
Lord
that
Commander.
He didn't because he's dismissed, sort of, you know, Aegon V's first act is to dismiss him. But
well, Mormon had
there's
long
a lot
thought.
Of like yeah, there's a lot of tumult at the time, and he's a clever dude. I think maybe it seems possible that he spirited Dark Sister away with him up
so
in the north.
So does Bran get Dark Sister?
Right? Can you imagine Hodor? What are we going to call Hodor and Bran? Brandor.
Brandor. Ooh, Brandor.
Brandor?
Brandor.
Ho-Bran?
Horan?
Bro.
Hodan?
Hodan?
Hodan.
Hodan.
Hodan and Brandor.
I think Brandor.
I think Brandor is
so
probably better.
Can you imagine Brandor with Dark Sister, the Targaryen ancestral sword, killing some fucking others? So if it's up there, it would be awfully convenient, right?
Do you think Valyrian steel can kill another just like dragon glass?
I think so. I think it's the same idea as dragon glass.
Well, I don't know. We know dragon Longclaw couldn't kill it, right?
Oh, he didn't. He had a regular sword at the time. Mm. He's gifted Longclaw
after that
for saving his life, yeah. Mm. And then he tries to be worthy. And in the fire, nobody used Longclaw because the fire melted the pummel and everything where he like through the tapestry on the other, or the white, rather. So we don't know. We've never seen it. But I think it is safe to assume that dragon glasses
is similar to Valyrian
steel. Is going to work against others. So that would give us a Targaryen sword in the cold, dead hands of a one-eyed Targaryen up in the north. So Brandor could have a sword. It would make sense. I mean, otherwise...
Yeah, I think it makes sense.
It would be in the... Somewhere like Robert... King Robert would have found it, or, you know,
or
like,
maybe it's buried in the crypts of Winterfell.
Yeah, it could be. But basically, like, if he left it behind, if King Aegon V was like, and you can't take Dark Sister with you...
Yeah, right.
Then... But I feel like maybe Aeg had a lot on his plate and wasn't thinking to, like, stop him from taking the sword with him. So, maybe in the
It probably wasn't very high on Egg's list anyway.
Exactly.
It's like, he's like, I want to have some dragons.
He's like, I'm a fourth son of a fourth son. What do I know about being a king? By the way, don't take that sword with you. Like, he's not going to think of it.
Yeah, no, I agree.
So, there's a good chance we have a Valyrian steel sword up north with Brandor. I like that, Brandor.
Oh, Brandor, I like that a lot.
Brandor.
And on that note, I think we're gonna end.
Well, what do you think? You gotta weigh in. Do you think Shiera Seastar is the mom? We haven't answered the question of who is the Red Woman. Who is she?
Well, she's Melisandre. Yeah. She's an old woman, and she's a sorceress. So in the last scene of the show,
She takes off her ruby.
She turns into this old woman.
She looks
woman.
Like super sad old lady.
She looks like she's like. The same sadness she is when she sees Jon Snow dead, and she makes the comment, like, I saw him fighting at Winterfell. Like,
life is over.
I saw it in the flames. I think she's like...
She's having an existential crisis.
I think she's almost at the point where she's looking at herself in the mirror, right? Yeah, she sees her old body, and she goes, I've lived a long life. I'm interpreting the flames wrong. Yeah. I'm getting things wrong.
Yeah.
Maybe she sacrifices herself to bring back Jon. I mean, only life... Can pay for life.
That's a good point.
So, you know, I think she's definitely at this point where...
There's nobody else that would love to kill themselves for
the good reason. Yeah.
Than
Melisandre. Yeah, absolutely. And she's definitely at this point where I must be doing something wrong. And
when Beric gave the kiss of life to Zombie Cat, she rose and he fell.
That's right.
It wasn't Thoros. Thoros was like, bitch has been dead for 3 days in a river. I'm not kissing her back to life. And Beric was like, if you won't do it, I will. And so then Beric dies. So maybe there's some sort of life transference. So that could happen. That was in the book. The show. I have no idea what they're doing in the show.
Yeah, I don't know. They'll have to figure that out.
Is old Nan Shiera Seastar? It would make old Nan a Targaryen. Possibly a dragon hatcher. If her mother was an ancient house from Valyria... And her dad is Aegon, who can only give his super-powered X gene.
X, that's right.
And her mom was the Lysenny Witch. She could be... And if old Nan is Shiera Seastar, then old Nan's a dragon hatcher. Not that it matters. She'd also be 120.
120.
Yeah, based on my math. Because we don't know what year Shiera was born,
which is surely possible.
I'm assuming it was 180.
How old do we think Master Aemon was? And we thought he was the oldest one.
It was 104.
Yeah.
And then I was like, do you think it's prohibitively old if Ronan, old
and
Weber.
Person was like, you're living in a world of dragons, hello.
But Rowan Weber doesn't make sense why she would leave her baby and Casterly Rock to go to the North. But it kind of makes sense
if Shiera Seastar
is still in contact with Brynden, and they're in this whole, like, prophecy. They can talk to each other through dark arts, and maybe there's, I don't know, they can communicate.
So Bloodraven is telling his lovely sister that he loves forever, go to Winterfell and hang out there, guard the crypts, or...
There was a prophecy, let's say, that a Brandon Stark would be born to this Stark lineage. That is the most powerful warg forever. And old Nan shows up when a Brandon Stark needs a wet nurse.
That's right.
That's when she shows up. Now that Brandon Stark ends up dying when he's 3 years old of a spring sickness or whatever.
But now we have a Bran Stark.
But three generations later, she just stays on until the real
Brandon Stark.
And she'd be 120. So
I like that a lot, man.
It fits way better than Ronan.
It fits so perfectly.
And then her.
So go back and listen to our old Nan episode, and then disregard everything we said.
Listen to it, but think of it as Shiera's Seastar and drink a 40.
And drink a 40 or two.
If anybody plays Wisest Wizard, I would love pictures.
Oh, absolutely. We did have one tweeter who said challenge accepted, so maybe he already played and forgot to take pictures, but
I feel like we should do Wisest Wizard one night, but it'd have to be a group podcast. That could be its own kind of wild and crazy
podcast.
Yeah.
That would be ridiculous.
Your house would get trashed.
Yeah.
I would be trashing your house.
Yeah.
I would throw things.
You
have a guitar right here. I'd smash it.
I have three guitars right here, and I hope you wouldn't smash any of them.
I wouldn't. I'm not a destructor. Look at me. I'm like a lover, not a fighter.
I don't know about that one.
It doesn't matter how much wizard warlock juice I have.
I've had a lot of wizard warlock juice.
I have respect for people's things, Dave.
Good. And on that note, respect for people's things.
Melisandre,
maybe. The daughter of Bloodraven and Shiera Seastar. Yep. Shiera Seastar staying on for the Brandon Stark that's going to be the most powerful warg, which we know.
But by the time he comes born, she's like super senile.
We know is yeah. Bran.
It's Bran.
That's Bran.
And there is a coming next week episode where we see him standing up somewhere, so we know we're going to see a Bran dream.
We are.
That's going to happen.
So that's where we're going to leave you this week, ladies and gentlemen, await the next episode of season 6.
Yeah, remember, Family Feud or Feud of Thrones.
Play along.
Play along at home.
Look for polls on Twitter and somewhere, we don't know yet, but look for some information on how you can make a vote.
Yeah. All right, guys, we'll talk to you next time.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for listening.
Nerds and neckbeards.
All I'm picturing right now is you as Steve Harvey. Like, that's all I can see. All men must drink. I seriously can only see you as Steve Harvey.
It's my mustache.
Right,
it's because
it's
of my
the mustache.
Luscious, it's my upper lip mustache.
It's absolutely the mustache. Absolutely.
Good night, ladies.
Good
and
night,
gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen. And you thought we were done, but we're not done.
We're done, but we're just dumb. We're not done.
Hey,
we're dumb.
Hey. What? We have some community news that we want to shout out.
So a little bit of housekeeping. Months and months and months ago, we had a contest, Dave.
Yes, we did. The first one to email us got us something, and Tana was super slow about getting the reward done.
As things happen.
Yeah, you know, we can all just blame her.
Yeah.
So
for everything. But it's done! So today, I finished my illustration, my first fan art illustration for Radio Westeros, who are our first emailers. They're our friends.
It only took you, what, almost
months.
A year?
It was months.
Almost
I think
a
it
year.
Was like March of last year.
But
something.
But I will
it
say
have
this.
Been. We started in June? So it couldn't have been. It's been months.
It's
though.
Been months. I'll tell you what though.
Yeah.
I've seen the artwork.
Yep.
It looks fucking awesome.
Do you like it? Do you think it came out cool?
I'm actually a little jealous.
Yeah.
Because like the artwork you drew for us is awesome too.
I love our banner idea.
But theirs is just like they're badass.
Yeah. Well,
you know,
I asked
ours
them.
Is more like, hey, we're fun and goofy. But theirs is like, he's got the sword.
I put
he's
Lady
got these
Gwyn with
the bow.
With,
yeah, with the bow.
And they gave that fletching, the like
fire
colors
yeah.
of Radiant.
And they've got their emblem on
yep,
there.
Their little
and,
logo on
and,
their
and
sleeves.
He's got like guard hands that say
oh,
RW
yeah.
Radio Westeros.
So
So
I drew the two of them back to back. And Lady Gwyn is holding a bow and arrow. You can see all this stuff on Tana 4 Designs, and also probably we'll put it up on our Podbean site.
Yeah, probably.
And then we're going to email it to them, too, right now. Probably after, before you guys, before any of this goes live, they'll have this in their inbox. And so it's like an arrow that Lady Gwyn has, and then she's got a little quiver of arrows on her back. And then Yoke Boy is holding a sword and an axe.
Yeah.
And they
he looks so
and
badass
they both have their
moment.
Like Radio Westeros logo that they have in flames, sort of in I tried to make it look like it was stitched onto their tunics.
Yeah.
And I gave them they really liked the heraldry of the North. So I did them in a lot of blues and grays.
Yeah, they it
and
definitely
I gave them, like,
looks
furry collars
definitely
and stuff.
Looks fucking awesome.
Yeah,
so, I'm jealous.
So we'll post
I'm
it
so
on
jealous.
Our Podbean and then Tana 4 Designs. But yeah, Lady Gwyn and Yoke Boy finally
get
Tana
there.
Pops up that artwork.
That's right. Everyone, make sure you go check it out and check out their awesome podcast because they do a much better job.
Everybody is listening to Radio Westeros, of course. They know what they're about. We're just
drunk idiots
we're
who like
it
to
for
ramble.
The drinks.
We're We're in it for the drinks.
We're in it for the strawberry shots.
So we'll probably be doing another contest soon, hopefully. Maybe.
We have another shaker that we could
We have another shaker that we can give away. Yeah. So
or we could do, like, I like game shows. We could, like, figure out some kind of game show.
That's a good idea. We'll have to take this offline and brainstorm that.
We'll brainstorm.
But look for something cool.
All men must drink, and all men must keep their promises, Dave.
That's right.
Which we do.
We are
reliable.
All women must keep their promises, too.
All women. All men and women. All people.
All people must keep their promises.
All human people.
All, well, and wargs. And
well, they're still
humans.
Are they humans? They're not inhuman, Dave. Don't try to discriminate against wargs.
They could be lizard people. Yes, I am. Anyway. Thanks for listening to our little after community news.
We forgot to mention that.
So thanks.
Yeah.
All men.
Must drink.
We're really going away this time.
Yeah.
This is the end.
Stop listening. Stop hanging out.
This is the end.
You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
It's closing time. Is it though? My house never really closes. Anyway, good night, everyone.
Good night.